When trying to explain the concept of what a function is to students, I like to describe a function as a machine. You put things into this function machine, and you get things out of this function machine. So as an example, let's say that this function takes inputs of people's social security numbers, and it does its thing, and it spits out the person's first name. As another example, we might have a function that takes an input of a person's DNA and gives an output of the person's age. So all the possible inputs of a particular function is called the domain of that function. So in the example where we're inputting social security numbers into the function, the domain of that function would be all possible social security numbers. The range of a function is all possible outputs of that function. So in the blue example here, the range would be all possible first names. It would just be a big list of all the first names of all the people who have social security numbers. Okay, well, what's the domain of the green function where we're inputting DNA? Well, it would just be all the different types of DNA. And the range of that function would be all possible ages. So that would be a list of numbers from, say, 0 to however old the oldest person is. Okay, so let's write down what the definition of a function is. All right, here it is. A function is a relation in which each possible input leads to exactly one output. Now, we have already discussed that each possible input has a name. We call it the domain. And all the outputs have a name as well. We call that the range. Well, there's one little hidden caveat in this definition, and it's the fact that we've written down that every domain value leads to exactly one output value. So if we plug something into this machine and it spits out more than one answer, that thing is not a function. So here's an example. If this machine inputs baseball player names and outputs their position, technically that wouldn't be a function because a given player could play more than one position. There's a chance that the machine would have to spit out more than one value for one given input, so that would not constitute a function. Okay, so this is a math class, right? We need to talk about what a function is to us in a math class. Well, y equals 2x is considered to be a function. We know that it's just a line through the origin with a slope of 2, but we can think of this as a function because we think of all x values as the domain. We input an x value into this function on the right-hand side here, and this function spits out a y value. So the domain, which is all the possible inputs of this function, is all the possible x values that we could plug into this thing. Well, and we could plug in any number we wanted. So as a side note, we call this all real numbers, or we could say negative infinity to infinity. The range is all the outputs of this function, which are y values. And since we know that this line could take on any y value possible, the range of this function is also all real numbers, or negative infinity to infinity. Okay, but the important thing to remember is that we always consider the domain in this class to be all the possible x values, or horizontal axis values, and we always think of the range to be all possible y values, or vertical axis values. Maybe what's most important to point out about this is that this is a function, because for every one x value that you plug into the function, you get out exactly one y value. Remember that exactly one output is very important. Let's look at another example. Graph of y equals x squared looks something like this. The inputs of this function are all the possible x values of this function. And just like before, there are no restrictions on this. Well, the range of this function is all the possible y values that are spit out by this function. And you'll notice that this function never spits out a y value that's negative. No matter what input we plug in, we always get an output that is a number that's 0 or bigger. So our range is all of our y values that are greater than or equal to 0. The way that we write this, and you'll talk more about this in class, is 0 to infinity. But most importantly, this is in fact a function, because no matter what, if you plug in one x value, you get exactly one y value out. Let's look at one more example really quick. Y squared equals x is a parabola turned on its side. What I want to point out here is that this is actually not a function. If we pick some x value to plug into this relationship, we actually get two y values out over here. So x is an input, and our relationship is outputting more than one value. So this is not a function. The way that we can easily think of this on a graph is with a vertical line test. If you can draw a vertical line and that line passes through your graph more than once, well, then this thing is not a function. So there it is. You can actually see that this graph up here, we could draw as many vertical lines through it as we like, and we're only going to cross that graph once with each vertical line. So that confirms that this thing is in fact a function. All right, if we find that we have a relationship that is a function, we can use a very special notation. We found that y equals x squared was a function, so we can replace the y with this thing right here. We call this f of x. This dude named Leonard Euler came up with this notation back in the 1700s, and it stuck because it's actually really good. In this example, we're naming the function f. Now in parentheses right next to the name of the function, we write down what our input variable is. And this right-hand side tells us what the machine does to that input variable. So what this machine does is it takes an x value and it squares it and it spits that out. So what if we want to plug x equals 2 into this function? Well, what we write is we just replace x with 2. We've input that 2 into the function now. And in the right-hand side, what the machine does is it takes that 2 and it squares it. And what the machine is going to spit out is the number 4. Well, what if we want to plug 3 into our function? Well, we just make the input variable 3. And on the right side, what the function is going to do is just take that number and square it. And it's going to spit out the number 9. We can get a little bit tricky with this. What if we want to plug in a, some number a? Well, the machine doesn't know what that a value is, but it knows that if it takes it in, it's just going to square it and spit out that number. So f of a equals a squared. We could get even trickier and plug in something like, say, a plus h. And well, it doesn't matter what you input, the function in this case is always just going to square that number because our function is x squared. Well, when I was a student learning about function notation, it always seemed strange to me that we would have to write down what our input variable was on the left side because you just see it right over here on the right side. So this always seemed kind of unnecessary to me. But as it turns out, the input variable is not always going to be the only letter you have on this side of the equation. So as an example, we have some function, I'll call it g, and on the right-hand side there are 4 different letters, a, b, c, and x. How do you know which one is the input variable or which one makes up the domain? Well, you know because that letter is right here in these parentheses. So it's a convenient notation because you know, okay, well, x is my input variable. That's going to be like my horizontal axis. But a, b, and c, those just must be numbers or constants, or sometimes we call them parameters. Those numbers aren't changing. Okay, that's all I got for you about functions and function notation. I hope that helps.